Today is Sunday, November the 12th, 2023, and another episode of Mendel's Musings. And today we're going to discuss me, because tomorrow, November the 13th,
what?
My birthday, and I'll be 60 years old.
Boy, hey. My daddy never lived to see his youngest reach 60. So that's another milestone for me.
That's true. That's true. That's right. How old were you when Grandpa passed away?
I was trying to think of that. I was in McPherson, so I was in my late 40s, early 50s, right in there.
It was 84 when he passed away.
He was 30 years older than me. And he died at age 76. So figure that it'd been 46.
There you go. Yeah.
Lord have mercy.
I know. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, we had a fun birthday party. The kids hosted a birthday party for me.
Good.
A lot of fun. We had family and friends and work colleagues and people from church and. It was really nice. It was really nice. The kids did a really great job.
And you didn't have to clean up afterwards.
I did not clean up.
Oh, very good.
I paid for the stuff, but I did not have to clean up.
Well, there you go. There you go.
We did a baked potato bar, a salad bar, and a Sunday bar. Now, I did make for the Sunday bar.
We did baked potatoes tonight, too, and had... And had broccoli cheddar soup
go with.
It was very good. So I am very satiated right now.
Don't go to sleep.
I won't.
All right. So, how did you guys find out that Mom was pregnant with me?
Well, that was an interesting time. A little bit of background. I made some notes here for some background here, but so a little bit of background was my father was bound and determined that he was going to mold my ministry into that right-wing fundamentalist framework. And so he announced that he was going to come pick me up. It was going to take Ruth and I to, I kid you not, Transylvania, Pennsylvania, to the Transylvania Bible School. And he wanted me to go there and study. And so your mother protested it very much, but I insisted that we go. And I think we took the boys to Lola for her to keep while we went. And on the way there, Ruth got sick. But it was just like the flu. She was throwing up and so forth. And so we talked about it wasn't until we were almost there and we talked about going home and decided that, you know, that wasn't probably a good situation. So we went on. She insisted that we go on, as I recall. But she was very much upset with me for allowing Dad to influence me to even go to this place and look at it. It was awful. It was a big dormitory kind of thing. Remember that movie, Cider House Rules?
Yes.
Remember that movie? And where they had the guys all in a place, and then at the end of the day, they throw the switch and shut off all the lights. Well, that's what they did there. They didn't have a dormitory for them, but they had individual rooms in the Bible school. And at night, when it came time to close off, they just good night, gentlemen, and turned off the switch, and all the lights went out, and everyone had to be up first thing in the morning for prayers. And I mean, it was just really draconian. And I said, well, you know, I'm married. I've got a wife and three kids, and that isn't something that we could do. Well, you could live in one of these other houses out here, but they have very strict rules, and they laid down the strict rules they were having. Well, it just kept getting worse and worse, and Ruth got quite sick. So we came home. We came home early. And
do you remember, was by chance, would this have been in March of
63? It must have been. It was in the early, and so what we, reflecting back on it now, we say she must have like morning sickness.
Okay.
That must have been what was going on. But for some reason, that wasn't considered, you know. Back in that day, Vicki, they took blood from the pregnant woman and put it into a rabbit. And if the rabbit died, that meant that the woman was pregnant. And, you know, so they called it the rabbit test. I think that's the way it worked.
I remember hearing about that, yeah.
And so we didn't know. And it was diagnosed, her condition was diagnosed as appendicitis, which meant that we had to have it worked on right away. So upon getting back, the very first thing that we did, I got her in to see Dr. Erickson, which was the only doctor in Windfall, Indiana, where I was pastoring the Pilgrim Holiness Church. That was the church that paid me $10 a week for my services and let us live in this really, really run-down shack for a parsonage. It was really bad. The doctor put her in the hospital at Tipton, Indiana, and they did an emergency appendectomy. And he told me afterwards, he said, well, when we cut her open, we realized that she's pregnant. She's carrying a child. And I said, oh, well, okay. I said, we've got three boys. I hope this one's a girl. He said, well, we really couldn't tell. It's not developed well enough for us to tell. But he said that, you know, she was pregnant. She told me that she had been told that there was like 1 in a million chance that you would be carried to term because of the trauma of that. But I never heard that from a physician. I did hear it from Ruth that she'd heard it from a physician. Now, that was back in the day. We were Pilgrim Holiness. We weren't allowed to wear jewelry. We didn't have wedding bands. We weren't married with wedding bands. They would say that the only wedding ring you have is, you have two wedding rings. One is the ring around the table, and the other one is the ring around the bathtub. And that's the only rings that they would allow. Then that was the joke that they said. So you know, this was really a traumatic thing for her. Having children in the hospital was traumatic because people assumed that we weren't married, and so that we had to go through all that rigmarole.
And she was young. I mean, she was
young, very young. Yes, very young. You know, because I mean, how old was she? She was.
She was 20 when she had me. You were both 25 when she had me.
Yeah.
She would have been just 20. You both would have been just 24.
I had four children.
Yeah.
So nevertheless, she got the surgery. Well, then I was. In the meantime, we left. That was during the time that I had already said I was going to go to school, and I was going to leave the pastorate there and was going to go to school, but I wasn't sure where I was going, and Dad was afraid I'd go to some liberal school and learn to be a liberal or something. I want to give you that.
Go figure.
And so that was what had made it that he was trying to get me to go to this friend's Bible school that was the Transylvania Bible College in Transylvania, Pennsylvania. I kept looking for Dracula to come around the corner, you know, hear gypsy music and all this kind of stuff.
That was got initiated, but you know.
I know. When I saw the Frankenstein monster, that was too much. So the deal was that I was in college. I was going to Marion College, and matriculate was in college. And she was quite large with you at that time. She decided that she wanted some curtains hung up over the sink in the kitchen in that parsonage that we had. And she probably had told me that, and I probably was busy conjugating Greek verbs or something. I don't know. But, you know, it was like, I was putting it off. I'm sure that's what the deal was. And so while I was gone, she climbed up on a folding chair out in the kitchen to hang those curtains herself, and she fell. And that just scared the bejesus out of me and out of her as well. And she was all bruised up. And then it wasn't too long after that that she was driving that old Falcon car that we had, that old Ford Falcon that that had bad piston rings in it and smoked up something terrible. And the kids in Sunday school were told that they should draw a picture of the pastor, and one of them drew a picture of a car with a big cloud of blue smoke out of the back of it, which was accurate. The trustees said to me, you know, this is embarrassing for you to have a car like that. We want you to get it fixed, get a different car. I said, I can't afford to get it fixed, and I can't afford another car. They said, well, we'll loan you the money. I said, no. I said, I'm not going to borrow money from you to do that. If you want to give me money to have my car fixed, I'll have it fixed. But I'm not going to borrow any money from you. I do not want to do that.
Right.
I was making $4,800 a year. I mean, come on. We were just barely scraping by. And that by that time, I was a Methodist at Mount Olive, just outside of Marion. So anyhow, Ruth was driving the car, had gone to the store, and that was, I think she was in about the eighth month, maybe then. And she had driven that car to go to the grocery store, and she was coming down Chapel Pike off of whatever that road, that main drag is. There was a big billboard on the corner that says, Christ is the answer.
Oh.
So Ruth was in the turn lane, to turn the left lane turn onto Chapel Pike, and a teenage girl was coming up behind her and passed her on the left and T-boned her. And the teenage girl said she was reading the sign.
Oh my God.
And she totaled the car. And it just, you know, we were really upset about that. And 2 or 3 days later, this teenage girl came to my house with her mom and dad. And they were so happy that we were Methodist minister. I was a Methodist minister. We were Christians, because they remembered that the scripture says that you're not supposed to take a brother or a sister to the courts. And so therefore they knew that we wouldn't file charges against their daughter.
Oh my God.
And I ordered them out of the house.
Oh my God.
It was outrage. Well, as it turned out, we didn't file charges. The insurance companies handled it, you know, but it just took a hell of a lot of work for us to get you here, Vicki.
Mom like go to the hospital after the wreck? I mean,
She went to the doctor to be checked out, and the doctor said she was all right. She had, I think she had a bruise on her knee from the door handle on the inside. That little Falcon was, you know, there wasn't much to him.
right.
And
Isn't that amazing?
somewhere I've got a photograph of that wreckage of
I'm
that Falcon.
yes, I remember you seeing it, and I was like amazed that mom was able to get out of it, especially if she was 8 months pregnant,
Oh,
because
yes.
it was pretty. So you got a new car on the deal from the insurance company?
I didn't get a new car. I got a different car, but yes, I did get a different car.
It didn't blow blue smoke anymore.
It didn't blow smoke. Lord have
Wow.
mercy. So that's the story, and I'm going to stick to it. And then you were born on the 13th. And my mother and dad came, and mother helped take care of Ruth and you for that first week or so. And I had gone on to school on the 23rd. And coming back, I heard the radio about that President Kennedy had been shot. And I came into the dining room, and mother was sitting in the rocking chair, rocking you. And I said, "They killed the president." And I remembered that really well.
Mom said that I had to be in the hospital for a few days, or
Yes, you were. Yes,
was that
yes.
because of me or because of her? Just
I think it was you, honey. I think it was you. You had something wrong with your feet, and I forget what they called it there, but it was like the feet were turned off to one side, and we had to put what they called the Browning splint, I think is what they called them, and they were a metal bar. And they fastened, you put shoes on you, and then you fasten that metal bar across the two shoes to hold your legs in the proper position so they would grow correctly. And of course, you just beat the tar out of the foot of that man. You just hit that sucker just as hard as you could.
Help build leg strength, right?
And I've often wondered if that's why sometimes you have difficulty with your ankles.
Yeah. Well, I've had doctors tell me that my feet are too small for as tall as I am. Well, so, that's always kind of weird.
There you go.
Well, I mean, I'm sure that the news of having a fourth child was not necessarily completely welcomed after having three boys that were young.
We were hoping for a girl.
I mean, did you ever just like get like, oh my gosh, we can't have another child, or
We did, yes, we did. After we found out that Ruth was pregnant with you, I took the boys with me. I don't know why in the world I'd do that, but I did. I took them with me, and we went to see the doctor, and the doctor that did vasectomies. And your mother and I talked a long time about that.
yeah.
She said she didn't want me to get a vasectomy. She said, "If something happens to me, you may want children still." And I said, "No, I don't want any more children." I said, "And besides that, nothing's going to happen to you." We decided then that I would do that. It just tells me that my internet connection is unstable.
Gonna say you did freeze for a minute, but
I did that the last time. I'm an unstable person. So anyhow, the doctor was a Catholic doctor, and he did the procedure in his office. And why it was important about him being a Catholic doctor, he really didn't want to do it. And I had to convince him. And so I brought the boys in and showed them. I said, "These are my three sons. My wife is out there and she's pregnant. I want a vasectomy." And so he damn near killed me with giving it to me. Yanked on the cord, and he was let me know he really didn't like doing it.
It's not approving.
And the next day, I conducted services out to Mount Olive Methodist Church. And one of the members invited us to go to lunch or go to have a meal after service with them. That was Lester and Georgiana Cates. And Lester and I set out on the porch swing. And that was not a good choice for me. That whole wooden that swing was really very uncomfortable at that time. We didn't
And you didn't want to tell them what you had just.
want to tell them what I'd done. And of course, Ruth and I, we just laughed till we cried afterwards about how funny that was. It was a good decision, but I'm glad I didn't have it before you were born, my dear, before you were conceived.
Thanks, Papa. I was afraid you're going to tell me that I was conceived in Transylvania.
Transylvania. Oh, Lord have mercy.
Did Mom have
But
any sickness?
the joys that I've had, Charlene was just telling me just at supper tonight that she was impressed by how much that my children enjoyed talking to me, and it was obvious that we had a good relationship and a good family life because my kids enjoyed having me around.
Absolutely.
Maybe
Absolutely.
that's because I'm not around all the time, and I give a blessing if I see a young couple or a young mother with a baby. I usually ask for the baby's name and how old the baby is, and then I say, "May they bring as much joy to you as my children have brought me." And it's a blessing that I give them. It's a non-denominational blessing for that child. And she said, that it was obvious that that was there. And I said, I can truthfully say that although we were very poor, we really were in poverty, but we weren't smart enough to understand
I was going to say, I never,
that.
we never knew it,
I did write on my 1040 form after Lyndon Baines Johnson was talking about his war on poverty, and I wrote across it, "Start your war on poverty here." No one ever responded to me at all.
the boys. I mean, how did you tell the boys that they were going to have a little sister or a little brother? I mean, or did they even know or understand that mom was pregnant?
They understood it as it went along, as her pregnancy went along, they understood. And we told them that she was pregnant, and that there would be a new person in our family, and that we hoped that it'd be a little girl. And Uncle Jim was very jealous of me
Oh,
for having a girl. As a matter of fact, oh, this is delicious, but as a matter of fact, when he was just a little toddler, Dwight, they had long hair, and they put him in a woman in a girl's dress and took a picture of him and said this was his little girl. Can you imagine Marilyn, how she would react to that now?
Gosh. Oh, yeah, that's so random. Yeah. Now
Was kind of funny. But yeah, Jim was very jealous, and he told me on very many times he told me that how jealous he was because I had a little girl. It made me feel good.
There you go. There you go. Well, what was it like when you brought me home from the hospital? How did the boys react? Do you remember?
I think they were very positive, as I recollect. Of course, you don't remember somebody saying one time when you were just an infant, we were going to be taking a trip to go down south. I think we were going to go visit mom and dad, and they lived down there. It's all fuzzy to me now. But we were going down to visit Marlene and Charlie, who lived down in Birmingham, and then we were going to go on down to the Gulf Coast because Ruth was familiar with that part of the country. And one of the guys in the church there at Mount Olive took his acetylene torch and cut up the windmill, the old windmill that was there on his place, and made a frame, and then put it on his boat trailer, and then built a box on that. And I borrowed that, and then we pitched a tent on top of that. So we had a camper and decided we were going to drive down there. So we had that on the back of our station wagon, and we had plenty of room inside the station wagon, and it was going to be just peachy keen wonderful. There are a lot of things that happened there, but one thing that I wanted to tell you about was that your mother and I stopped at it was like a it wasn't a dollar store. It was before they had those, but it was like, I forget the name of it now, Grace department store or something like that there in Marion, Indiana. And your mother had to get something inside the store, and I was in the store at the same time. So anyhow, we left all four of you kids in the car, and Brian got into your mother's purse to the lipstick and decided that he wanted to make you look a little bit brighter, and so he painted your lips with lipstick and had it smeared all over you. And we came back to the car, and of course no one knew how that happened.
Was Brian. I mean,
Well,
obviously.
you were not very happy about that, as I recall. You were crying. And
It was the start of Brian torturing me. I'll get you, Brian.
yeah, he really painted you up. He painted you up like a Jezebel, tell you.
Well, did David or Joe spill the beans on Brian, or how did you figure it out it was Brian?
Yeah, they did. Yeah, it was obvious he had. It's like that story that Al Sharpton told about his mama that baked a blueberry pie. And then she came into the kitchen and she said, "What happened to that blueberry pie? Somebody eat my blueberry pie?" And he said, "No, mama, we didn't eat your blueberry pie." And he said, "We had blueberry stains all over our hands and faces."
Yeah, it would be obvious.
It was sort of like that. It was pretty easy for us to see who the culprit was because he had almost as much lipstick on him as you did on you.
I can imagine your initial reaction to be, oh my God, but then it was also probably
You
because that would have been.
understand, he was very young, honey. He was,
He would have been five.
yeah, he was very young.
He was very precocious, even. Oh, that's funny.
But we survived. That trailer, that's the one that we had, and we stopped in Bowling Green, Kentucky on our way down, and we stopped in there at Aunt Claire Marie and Uncle Ed York's home, and Ed was Sergeant York's son, a big shot, you know, and the Nazarene preacher there in Bowling Green, Kentucky. And we pulled in, and we had told them we were coming, but we pulled in, it was kind of late, and so the kids were wanted to lay down, so I just pulled in the drive and popped up the tent and put the kids in bed, and decided we were gonna, well, Ed came home, he'd been gone, and he saw that, and he threw a conniption fit about these gypsies that had moved in on him. He acted awful. That was the last time I ever went to his home, by the way.
Oh, wow.
I didn't want to be around him. He was very unwelcoming of us. And it was just like he was just outraged that we would, what are our neighbors going to think about us? And it was kind of a hokey looking thing. I mean, it was hokey looking, but I mean, after all, family is family, right?
Exactly. They probably didn't
So,
need to come in the house with all those kids.
right, it was a little late, and so I just popped up to dinner. That car, I had put retread tires on the car, and the doggone thing, there was so much weight because of that trailer that I lost four of those tires. They just stripped out. I don't know if you know how retreads are, but you know what a retread is, right? And the tread just peeled off of them. I had to buy tires. The solenoid went out on it, and I had to take a screwdriver to start it. And I had to short out the solenoid, so we'd pull up at a stoplight, and it would die on us. So I'd pop the lid, and then Ruth would slide over and to so she could start it, and I'd get under the lid and short out the solenoid so we could start.
Gosh, Dad. Did you make it all the way to the Gulf Coast?
We made it all the way to the Gulf Coast. Then we got down there, and the sand fleas were so terrible, they just about ate us alive. Your mother got so sunburned, it was just terrible. She was so fair, that she
Didn't
just
take
got sunburned so terrible.
And it wasn't like you get sunscreen, they
Yeah.
didn't have sunscreen available like that. Oh, that's funny. Oh my goodness.
It was quite a trip.
So by the time I was born, you were preaching in the Methodist Church. You had left the Pilgrim
Yes.
in the Wesleyan.
Yes. That was all during the time. The people at the Methodist Church, they just absolutely loved you. Just loved you. Our little Vicky, they would call. And you were baptized there at that Methodist Church by the district superintendent, whose name was Dr. Lawshe, Lawshey. I think his first name is Ernest Lawshe. And Arvella was his wife's name. They were just very, very good to me. I mean, they really were. I come from the Pilgrim Holiness Church. They didn't know but what I'd be frothing at the mouth, or what would be going on. And they hired me in there on my credentials that I had at the Pilgrim Holiness, with the understanding that I would pursue my education, which I did, and eventually got my deacon's orders in the Methodist Church.
And that was in Sweetser, right?
Yes, it's just Sweetser is the address. It is just outside of Marion, Indiana. That's quite a large church now. The last time I was there, they had several pastors.
Oh, wow.
But
the closest hospital was the one in Tipton, right? So that's why I was born in Tipton.
You were born in Tipton because that's where the doctor was that we had taken your mother to for the pre-surgery, kind of pre-birth.
Prenatal care.
Thank you, prenatal. I couldn't think of the right word. Prenatal care. And so we took you back to him. And he's the guy that said to him, I told him that we were going to name you Caboose. And he said, you know, the last week I saw a train that had four cabooses on it. And I said, all right, we're getting out of here. This doctor is fired.
But you already fixed it, so there wouldn't be any more cabooses. I wouldn't be the only one.
He was a nice man.
And then my first babysitter was Dodie Foltz.
Yes.
And she was a member of Mount Olive or Mount Comfort.
Yes. At Mount Olive.
Olive.
You remember Mount Olive, yes. And she had been a worker in the voter registration office in Chicago before her and Alf had moved to Marion.
I didn't know
Marion
that.
Area. And she could tell us some stories about Chicago Democratic politics.
Well, how did you guys come to pick her to take care of me?
You know, I don't remember. I think she just may have just glommed onto you right away. I think that may have been it. But she was a dear, dear soul. Dear soul. And her husband, Alf, was as well. Just
he was
all of the earth.
He was very quiet, but I remember walking around the garden with him to pick, you know, cantaloupes and watermelons and peas and stuff. And I don't remember him talking very much, but I would follow around with, you know, all around him. And do you remember how much you paid her when you first?
I do not remember. No. I don't remember that at all.
I remember her. I thought she had.
It couldn't have been very much because I only made like. I think the first year I was there, I made 43. I was there 5 years. And no, I was there 4 years. And I was making $4,800 when I left. So we couldn't have paid her much.
I remember she had this, what I thought was a big bed when I was, you know, my earliest memories. And she had to put me on the bed because it was tall. But, you know, looking back on it now, she wasn't a very tall woman herself. But,
no.
And then she put pillows around me. I remember her putting pillows around me so I wouldn't fall out of the bed. And I, you know, it's like one of my earliest memories and sitting on her porch, snapping peas together. I probably wasn't doing a very good job, but she was snapping peas and I was just sitting there. I just enjoyed just,
yes,
and hang out with her. And
well, even when you were in grade school and we lived in Marion, we'd been gone, she still followed up on that. We still had good connections there.
I would just spend weekends with her while you guys were off doing something. And I would assume you guys paid her for that, wouldn't you? Or try?
I'm sure we did.
And I remember when Alf passed away and she called you to tell you that, you know, you were like one of the first people to call. And then I would go I would go after he, when I would go, when they moved out of the big farmhouse and that little bitty house that was near the church, it had like a little bitty up, it wasn't a full upstairs. I think it must have been like an attic, really narrow staircase that was out of the bedroom. And I would go up there to sleep. And then after Alf died, I would sleep in the bed with her, but boy, did she snore.
Well, it prepared you for Ron.
I would reach over to pat her on the back to get her to stop snoring, and she would stop. Oh my God, there was time, and I would go, I wanted to go to bed before she did, because if I was asleep, she
Maybe
didn't,
you wouldn't hear
you wouldn't hear it as much, right? But yeah, she taught me how to bake cookies. I remember that. Her
it.
molasses cookies. Ooh, they were so good. And
Oh, yeah, her molasses cookies were to die for.
we would sit out when she lived in that little house. We would, because there was, nothing to do there, but we would sit out in the back in her backyard and try to guess the color of the cars coming by. And it was a game to see
Oh.
who would guess the color of the cars. It was this, I'm looking back at it now, it's like, that was probably very boring for her, but she seemed to enjoy it. She seemed to, but I know Alf had a daughter, Gladys, right?
Yes.
But Mary, or but her real name was Mary, but Dodie didn't have any children of her own, did she?
I don't think so.
She would call like everybody that she babysat, her girls, but I never knew any other children that she babysat. I know that she did because she talked about them, but because when she babysat me, I would be like the only one. I think one time there might have been, well, then Dolores would go with me when, when, and Dolores seemed to really enjoy going to her, but she was, because of my grandparents' weirdness and Grandpa William is being so sick, she was kind of like the grandmother to me that I have as a little kid. And
Yeah, when you talk about the weirdness, you're talking about the fact that they were so tied up in fundamentalism, they kept trying to convert everybody. Bad situation.
I do
It
remember.
wasn't until Dad died that my mother was able to get out of that a little bit.
Oh, yeah, I mean, she cut her hair, she got a TV. I mean, she was letting loose. And, I do remember when Grandpa would come visit us. I remember on Jeffers Street, he would come visit, and we would sit in the living room, and I'd climb up into his lap, and he would have like a dollar bill stuffed in his, and I would go searching for it because I somehow I knew there'd be a dollar bill in there, and you or Mom would get mad at me about. And he'd say, no, I put that in there for her. I was searching around in his pocket, like taking the pins out.
It just, I had a flashback. I remember when you were a toddler that we went to the Indianapolis fair, and I held you on my lap and sang Thank Heavens for Little Girls,
Yes.
and you rummaged in my pocket and took the pencils and papers out of my pocket. You probably were looking for a dollar bill.
Didn't you win a you did honorable mention or something for that, or
Well, that's what Brian tells. There was a picture that's floating around somewhere of that they published at the 4-H fairgrounds in Indianapolis
finding
that
it?
showed us up on the stage with them. And I played corded on the piano, and we sang Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. Brian tells it that that was his introduction to a big time musical career.
Now, I do know, I mean, you said about I had problems with my feet, but I also would got sick a lot as a baby, right? And
Yes, you had a lot of allergies. just a lot of allergies. And we found one of them was they did all those tests where they would make pricks on your back and put.
That it was on my arm. I
Oh,
remember
it
that.
was awful. And then whatever in festered, then they'd say that's what you were allergic to. You were allergic to dog hair or dog dander. We had a long-haired dog, and we had to get rid of the dog because of that. And
wasn't there a story about a Great Dane that helped me learn how to walk, or was that the long-haired dog that helped me?
I don't know about a Great Dane. We never had a Great Dane.
I just remember that there was a story.
It may have been that long-haired dog. You held on to the
yes, that's what
to
it
the
is.
Hair on the dog. That might have done that.
Well, how did you in that allergy testing? I know because you guys discovered I was allergic to penicillin.
Yes.
Baby, right? Even before the allergy testing, or was that a result of the allergy testing as well?
Yes, it was the allergy testing. Did that.
I remember mom saying, you know, she could just hear me wheezing in the, and wasn't I in the, I remember mom saying something. I was in the hospital one time with an oxygen tent.
It has an oxygen tent, they call it. Yeah.
Yeah. And she would sit with me like all day long, right? I mean, I remember her saying she sewed a lot of by hand.
Yeah, it's pretty scary.
What?
It looks like my internet connection is unstable again. There it goes.
I can hear you just fine. But
okay.
Mom's saying she made a lot of dresses for me by hand, sitting in the hospital with me.
She was very good about a seamstress among several. She had several talents, Vicki, that she had several.
So how'd you guys come up with calling me Vicki?
You know, I don't know that. I don't know. I think Vicki, I think Ruth chose that name.
Because she told me that when she was pregnant with me, the plan was to call me Susan. Do you remember that?
Susie, yeah.
And that, but then when I was born, she decided I looked like a Vicki.
That's true. That is true. I'd forgotten that. Yes, we did. We named the unborn fetus, we named Susie. And there was a song about Wake Up Little Susie, about the little girl that went to the movie with this guy, and she went to sleep, and he was afraid they were going to get in trouble because she went to sleep. And they
wake up.
Well, I think that may have been where we got that name.
No. Oh, that's
and funny. The only time I ever called you Victoria is when you did something I was reprimanding you for.
That's right.
It wasn't very often.
Exactly. Victoria Ruth. Exactly. Exactly. Well, yeah. Well, here I am. 60.
Here you are, 60 years later. Lord have mercy.
I know. Well, thank you for.
It goes fast now, honey.
Yeah, that's
it
what I've
fast.
That's what I've heard. Yeah.
Doesn't seem possible.
Well, the kids, Sarah and Peter and Caitlin, were just. I had a really good weekend and.
Godsend.
Yeah, they cleaned out. They cleared out the garage and then repacked it, and we got rid of some stuff and. I can get the car in the garage, but I wouldn't be able to get out of the car yet. So I just need to move some stuff around. But
you can crawl over the back seats and out the back.
Exactly. But they did an amazing job. It's really just, And they there was no fighting, there was no fussing, and they just got the job done. So while I was off getting my nails done and getting my hair done, and Ron was sitting out there with them and made some tough decisions to get rid of stuff. And we have even more decisions to get rid of stuff. And I'm all for just purging to get rid of stuff. So
I understand that.
Yeah.
Well.
All righty. Well, don't call me at 3:30 in the morning.
3:30 in the morning. I'll give you a call, honey.
Because I was at 4:30 in the morning. Did they have daylight savings time back in then in 63? Or, I mean, they didn't.
I don't remember. what time does Ron go in for his tribute tomorrow?
We have to be there at 3:45.
In the evening.
Yeah, in the afternoon.
Afternoon.
And it'll take about 3 hours.
Well, that won't be quite so bad.
And then Tuesday, we have to be there at 4:45.
I know he'll be just drained when that's over, if you'll pardon the expression.
Right.
I think he will be.
I think I'll make him feel better, though.
Yeah, it should. Well, tell him I'll be thinking about him.
Thank you.
Pulling for him.
I'll keep you posted.
All right. Take care. Love you. Bye-bye.
I'm going to stop the recording.